Welcome. We are conducting a lecture series on the English novel, and a large number of novels have already been covered. And today's lecture would be on D.H. Lawrence, and keeping in mind his text, The Sons and Lovers, which is an important text on all accounts. And the expert with us today is Dr. Richa Bajaj, who teaches English in a Hindu college, Delhi University. And before I request her to start a lecture, let me put a question to her. You know, D.H. Lawrence is known as a novelist or a fiction writer, but he also had, Dr. Bajaj, he also had written a large number of books, you know, containing ideas, comments, even criticism. And he had a politics, he had a social vision, he was inspired by nature, he was inspired by, you know, a kind of instinct and the Freudian thought that only human beings had. And yet, you know, he was able to establish a kind of identity for himself as a novelist of nature. So, a thinker, a poet, a fiction writer, all rolled into one. How would you define him if you were asked to, requested to?
Thank you, Professor Prakash. I agree with what you just said. He is a versatile artist. I'd call him that to begin with, in the sense that he's actually a man of ideas. I mean, we also know that he wanted to build a kind of a utopian society, and he said that, well, some of us, he offered this to his friends, and of course, only two people were ready to join him in his utopia. He wanted to build a utopia, settle in on an island with only a few people who were like-minded and believed in, you know, similar kind of ideas. So he did mention building a kind of, making a kind of a communism. He used that word also, where a kind of a utopian society where there'd be no war and bloodshed. And so there is, in fact, I'd like to say that Lawrence is, you know, pre First World War and post First World War, is a changed person also, because he's becoming more open with time, and the certain kind of peculiarities in characters that you saw, say, in early Lawrence, you don't get to see them in the later one. In his later fiction, he becomes more open ended and desiring to know and change. So that is, I think, a very interesting take on Lawrence. Lawrence is, I don't know how, but Lawrence is a writer who is as poetic as he is intellectual. I don't know if these can go together, in the sense that he's sensuous. He can live with the world of nature. He can enter almost like Keats in each aspect or each living being in nature. He's particularly fond of flowers and the foliage, and he enters them, he becomes one with them, and then he's able to draw himself out and talk like an intellectual. In fact, if we notice, most of his novels, you know, end with a sort of a intellectual take on life. I mean, it's his kind of very peculiar kind of identity that the novels have.
Would you call him a prophet of peace, as some people have called him?
Yes, he was a pacifist in that sense, and he did face a lot of flak because of being a pacifist during the First World War, so much so that he had to leave England with his wife, who was German, and people looked critically at him. Also because he was writing novels which were considered obscene, and the Rainbow that was written during the World War faced a lot of criticism, and he felt compelled to, it was a willful exile, if you call it, but he felt compelled to leave England, and England for good.
And some people called him the priest of love. In fact, that was the title of a film made on him. So would you call him a priest of love also?
I don't know, priest, and Lawrence would disapprove of the word priest for sure, if one were to call him priest. But yes, love is at the center of things in his, in his mind, but love of the kind which is very close to the spontaneous, instinctual kind of love, which is why a lot of people have also called him primitive, or, you know, a votary of a kind of primitivism in life, wherein you find that his kind of writing gains sustenance from primitive urges. You know, the basic point being that life was simpler when we didn't have industrialization, and life was so it's good to go back to that kind of life which was simpler, and that we have made it complex. There is a sense that complexity of relationships also, they are not innately complex in Lawrence. They become difficult to deal with, complex in themselves, because of the circumstances outside and the desiring subject, or the willful subject.
Will you call him a primitivist for that in that sense?
Not really. Actually, I wouldn't call him. He has his own. As I said, he's more a philosopher in that sense, and he has his own philosophy on life in that sense. He's, I think, trying to deal with the present day crisis in Europe, and one way of dealing it. You see, I think all these, if we look at Lawrence as part of the entire modernist paradigm, if we look at him within that paradigm, then each writer tries to find some kind of resolution.
You say, and the Lawrence, present day. So present day would include the 21st century. He's still relevant?
No, I meant the present day of his own time. I meant the 20th century and the modernist era. What I meant to say was that in his time, writers, all of them, tried to find some kind of resolution, whether it was politics, religion. So I think Lawrence found it in this kind of primitivism that you're talking about, this kind of simplicity of life, because he thinks that, again, taking probably from Rousseau or from Freud further on, that as we move into civilization, as we create structures in society, we create desires, we create wills, we create a sense of self which undermines the basic self, or in fact destroys the natural self. And that is, I think, what Lawrence seems to be saying, that as human beings we have a very natural instinctual self which is beautiful and which has love at the center, but as social beings we have destroyed that self. So in order to reclaim that self, that instinctual primitive human being who is beautiful for Lawrence, one needs to take recourse to a different different paradigm. And for him, this is what he means by, or this is what critics probably would want to say when they refer to him as a kind of having a primitive consciousness. Some critics have gone on to actually call it a kind of modern primitivism. Modern primitivism, which is situated in the modern world, but then wants to inhabit that world that probably we have gone away from. Now, is it regressive? Is a question that we might want to address, that opens up by wishing to go back in time and to be in a pre-industrial world. Is Lawrence suggesting a regressive way out? Because industrialization, of course, brought in a lot of evils along with it, but it also brought in progress, and human beings learn to use the machine to one's advantage. That is another thing, that the machine began to dominate.
That's a very appealing view of D.S. Lawrence. So maybe you can develop on these points further.
Let me first give the viewers an introduction on the life, perhaps, of the man and the novelist, D.H. Lawrence. So if you look at the slide, let's just have a look at the a kind of a brief biographical kind of a note on D.H. Lawrence. So he's basically David Herbert Lawrence, born in 1885 and till there around 1930. So he had seen the First World War and had the experience of it, and the view that he built on the war situation, so his later works really carry that force, carry that kind of a viewpoint that he built and that he evolved while facing the conditions and the world that was dealing with the First World War. Now let me take you to his life. For instance, where does he come from? What were his parents like? What was his upbringing like? Now, of course, there might be a reason why are we looking at this. Now, why? Because Lawrence is a writer who draws a lot of his fictional works from his life. His life, so to speak, becomes the fodder on which he on which his novels feed or on which the novelist feeds. He takes up an aspect of his life and then builds around it a whole world. So trying to understand Lawrence's life is very important in order to understand his works, because they deal with one or the other predicament or dilemma that he faced in his life. Now, if you go back to the slide, you will notice that Lawrence grew up in the countryside. So a mining village of Nottinghamshire, England. He grew up in the countryside. That was on one hand, had this beautiful landscape, and on the other, there were these ash pits and mines. So the contrast was right there. Lawrence, in fact, in his essay, Nottingham and the Mining Countryside, says that the mines were almost like an accident in the landscape. So you can see that how here you find that Lawrence himself commenting on the life that he had. It was beautiful and ugly at the same time. The place that he grew up in, which had mines, and the life of miners that he saw, it was utter poverty, but then there was this beautiful landscape also that accompanied it. So how the beauty and the beautiful and the ugly, they in a way came together in his early life. Lawrence's father, now again, that kind of a contrast or juxtaposition actually continues, the beautiful and the ugly. You find another contrast or juxtaposition. While Lawrence's father was a miner, he had little education and spoke, the dialect of the region. He captures this dialect beautifully in Sons and Lovers. But the dialect has its own tenderness, its own sweetness that he talks in. And you find that Lawrence wants to use that dialect in order to show the people and their lives. So Lawrence's father spoke in that dialect of the region, and he was a miner. Little education, and the life of the miners, their culture, how they lived, how they spent their day, what was their life like. The mining community became a stock theme in Lawrence's work. His awareness about his class and his culture also found way in his novels. Now, very different from his father was his mother, who was an educated, refined, religious, Puritan, middle-class woman who had chosen, that man who was full of life and who was morally upright, so whose moral uprightness really left a lasting impact on him. And then the clash between the parents is explored at length in the novel Sons and Lovers, as we all know. So again, as I was saying, so the clash, the pitching one against the other, the middle-class, refined mother and the raw, rustic father, a minor father with no education, the landscape which is beautiful and the mine which is ugly. So these juxtapositions exist in his work, and they seem to create this kind of clash in the novels. Let's move ahead. Lawrence's life, this was about his background, about the place that he lived in, and about his parents. If you move further, you find what kind of man was he, how was he growing up. He was a bright student in school and was able to fetch a scholarship to Nottingham High School. At the age of 16, he decided to earn a living, and he worked as a clerk in a factory. And later he took to teaching and writing, and this is his writing period that is sort of this is his formative years, but also years when he dabbled in writing. This happens around 1902 or so. And then Lawrence joins the University College Nottingham in 1906, returns to teaching in 1908 in a London suburb. And this is followed. So 1908, after having received the degrees, the certificate that he can teach, he is now at ease and can devote himself to writing. So this period is a period of intense intellectual work. And as many of his novels get published and get appreciated in literary circles as well. Let's look at before we look at his works, let's also look at his association with different women. So Jessie Chambers, of course, was one of his early love, adolescent love, but later on he marries Frieda Weekly, who was a German woman and a married woman, married to his professor, who he runs away with and marries. Both of them, Lawrence and Frieda Weekly, they leave England, as I was suggesting, for Italy in 1919. and his view on pacifism, on criticism, and you know, his novel was being termed obscene. So he was viewed as a kind of a subversive writer by then. And so Lawrence left for good, left England for good, and traveled to, decided to go to America, but taking the east way. So he traveled to Sri Lanka, which was Ceylon then, and Australia to go to America, and then came back to Italy. But by the time he came to Italy, he was already ill and suffering from tuberculosis in 1925. He then also again, but you know, he continued to write. He was writing, he was you know, a prolific writer, writing at a good speed at, during this entire decade. And in his final years also, while he was writing and he traveled to France, he died in 1930. So that puts an end to his career, but you know, he kept on writing even when he was ill throughout this decade. These are some of the notable works of Lawrence, actually notable novels. He wrote many plays, poems, short stories, novellas, work, critical works as well. But the first novel that came up, you know, was The White Peacock in 1911, and followed by Sons and Lovers in 1913. I'd be looking at Sons and Lovers in particular in this, in the second part of the series. But just to give you an overview of these different works, so how he's building. So there is The Rainbow, which comes in 1915, and then Women in Love and Lady Chatterley's Lovers that comes in the post First World War period, right, 1921 and 1928 respectively. Let's now, so this is about the life of Lawrence, really speaking, where he grew up, what kind of surroundings he had, and what made him, so the formative years and how these made the person that he was.
You talked about autobiography. So was he presenting his experience in life, or was he picking up characters that he might have met in life in order to use them for fictional representation?
Yes, certainly. I mean, if we look at Sons and Lovers for particularly, we know that it is quasi-autobiographical, and that he has picked up these characters, especially the character of his mother and father and Jesse Chambers, from his actual life and turned it into Miriam in the novel. Clara was again an imaginative piece that he put in there. But certainly, you know, he picked up these, and you know, in his later novels, the character mostly moves from you know, from England and goes to Europe, so suggesting his own movement.
Was he critically appraising these characters, his mother, his father, Chambers?
I think he was resolving issues of his own life. I think Lawrence understood that these were knots in his head that he wanted to untie, and he wanted to open and see what was the root of these problems. So I think he was one of those writers who could be in the moment and evaluate his own life, and wasn't self-conscious or wasn't embarrassed to do so, to be able to pick up an aspect of his life and draw that out. Like marriages, for instance, even in Women in Love, he's able to look at marriages at length, right? In Sons and Lovers, he's exploring marriages and relationships and how he deals with his own life within these, you know, these novels then seem to be resolving issues of his own life in that sense.
Primarily, is he struggling with himself in these novels, or is he struggling with other characters like his mother, like his father?
He's struggling with issues and concerns that tangentially, in a way, relate to his life. At some places, it is he himself he's trying to explore and understand, or a particular phase in his life that he's trying to explore and understand.
But he's not wallowing in self-experience.
I don't think so. He is wallowing in self-experience because he is able to move out of that framework. Mm-hmm. If you look at his early novels and later novels, you do find a shift. So it's not, if he were wallowing, then I don't think a writer would have grown in that sense. He's able to shift from his earlier stance and change it, and or at least tweak it in a way. I don't think his novels are replicas in that sense.
Idea from your use of the word modernist. So in that sense, he's not a modernist, or is he? Because modernists generally wallow, you know, in their own misery, in their own uncertainty. they go over it, they change themselves, they reassess, and all those things.
But you think, and I agree with you,
that he is not a modernist in that sense at all.
I think modernism is a very middle class notion.
Mm-hmm.
And writers too comfortable in their lives could afford that kind of a paradigm, that kind of a thought process.
Mm-hmm.
Lawrence was a part of it, but I don't think he has been all along a part of it. He has withdrawn from it often and been a part of it. So I think if you notice, you know, his works often will give you in the middle, the narrator would turn a philosopher.
Mm-hmm.
And will give you a sense of, you know, a take on life, that, you know, what is life? Life just takes you along and you have no control on it. And you are just swept over. And at some places, you know, he couldn't connect, you know, this kind of alienation, for instance, I would say. I mean, if I were to pick up words, modernist thematic concerns and look for them in Lawrence, I would say alienation perhaps is one of them. The self-conscious modernist hero is certainly there. Right, to be unable to come to terms with life with all its you know, expects you to be somebody, and the character cannot in that moment. So there is this kind of self-consciousness, there is this kind of modernist sort of a interrogation of the self, and at the same time a kind of alienation that the writer is unable to, or the narrator or the character, they are actually unable to connect with other characters. So I think that is how you can place him in the modernist paradigm. But I don't think he's, because he has a very strong kind of base in the working class community. He often is able to be an outsider within the modernist middle class circle and look at them from the outside. So, which is why I felt that, you know, he's unembarrassed in that sense, in looking at his own self, you know, and critiquing himself as well within that paradigm.
Which means that he has this very strong modernist streak.
Right.
That he keeps his individual self at the center of the novels.
Hmm.
And yet he's critical of the tendencies that surround him. And for that reason, one has to take a second look at the way he represents himself and his writing. So I think that's a good way to understand Lawrence as a writer, as a philosopher, as a poet, as a thinker, and that all this will be reflected in his texts at one level or another. Thank you.